Welcome back to Rush Hour. Now we get into the big issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. Thank you for staying on Urban TV. Now, last week we published a very interesting story which showed rifts deepening in the main opposition National Unity Platform, where the leader of opposition is put on the spot to explain where his true standing in legislation. Is there an excess or a gap in the legislative approach of Mathias Mpuuga, who is now the leader of opposition, or it is just he's becoming a victim or a captive of some of his radical supporters? Now, this is not the first time opposition leaders or leaders of opposition in parliament are facing it hard to serve the interest of their parties or their electorates and also remaining true and alive to the rules and procedures of the National Assembly. Many of the previous, all the predecessors, or the previous leaders of opposition have faced this tough, and some of them have ended up being reshuffled, while others have ended up leaving their political parties and joining new political parties. We want to understand what should be the alternative government's approach in the National Assembly. What should be the appropriate legislative approach that can as well better serve the people that you're representing, but at the same time maintaining the rules? We saw a scenario in Parliament last week where one of the members of the National Unity Platform went to on the floor of Parliament and did not want to listen to the communication from the chair, that was the Deputy Speaker, Thomas Taiyebwa. Now, many of their supporters defended him, saying that the current leader of opposition government has been quiet on the alleged abduction of their supporters, and that's why he turned out to be having and also engaging in that misconduct. We are asking a question: what does it take to be an effective leader of opposition, and how can a leader of opposition serve the interest of his supporters, but at the same time sticking to the rules in the National Assembly? Joining me to discuss and dissect that are two distinguished politicians. And that's Joseph Ocheno. He's a Uganda People's Congress member, but also a political analyst. And Honorable Emmanuel Dombo, Director of Information and Publicity at the ruling National Resistance Movement. He will be joining us via Zoom, and we'll be talking to him later. But for now, we're joined by Joseph. A very good morning, Joseph, and thank you so much for joining me.
Good to be here, always.
Joseph, I know for sure that you subscribe to an opposition party, which is the Uganda People's Congress. First of all, what are your comments and what are your views regarding this whole bickering within the main opposition political party?
I think it's extremely unfortunate because this country very urgently needs leadership. To the extent that even if the ruling NRNRM had been in power only for 5 years, it would require that an alternative set of values, and therefore the main opposition, continuously presents to the country sets of values and thinkings for which a 17-year-old young, sharp boy or girl would say, you know, by the time I turn 18,
I need to vote for this
party. I think I should go for these guys. They make sense. That is a challenge. Number two, I think because we had had such a long period of time of monolithic polity, once pluralist politics came in, most of our political players are basically just learning the game. And for that reason, I am very strong on encouraging universities and colleges and secondary schools to engage youngsters in debates. And debates not only for helping them to do critical thinking, but to present whatever sets of ideals they might want to represent. Those, in my opinion, are substantially lacking today across the political divide, including the ruling NRA. It's not surprising, therefore, that Mr. Museveni would sometimes shake guys, not that way. But back really to the whatever is happening, I think that emergent political parties. I'm very lucky. I represent the oldest political party, 1952. Yes. So maybe I shouldn't be very, very excessively proud, take too much credit, but because it's just an organization that was founded. So we've had a long history. Mm. Our own founding president, Ignatius Musazi, was actually dismissed by the party in 1958. And then 59, and then Obote was elected to replace him. So those are internal issues. So by 1960, Obote, 59, Obote reunited UP, 60, Obote reunited UPU and UPC, and then founded Uganda People's Congress. Mm. And thankfully for him, because UPC is a political party with organized sets of values and ideology, at the time we had these very sharp men and women in this country. I don't know where they've gone. Mm. So it was very easy.
Most of them have joined the NRA.
Indeed. maybe they're just spending time there for whatever reason. So yes. It means that over a period of time, we had a political party, mature sets of values, sets of rules and organizations, games of procedures, urgent issues to do with the national democratic liberation, our independence, and after that we say we're delivering for our country. These are programs, these are manifestos, they're going to run by that. Party rules that says if a member of parliament, this is what your expectations are. From a party point of view, not when you go into the National Assembly, a local party branch, this is what you do, this is what you don't. This is what Uganda People's Congress represents. And in the unlikely event that you find yourself somewhere around Chinoni, if you behave like this, particularly if it's a president or chairman, you'll face the disciplinary procedures. Mm. Those are things that to date do not exist. Fast forward to the democratic opposition, and we're talking before we came on air. Once multi-partism allegedly returned, we found that the makers of the 1995 NRM constitution did what most African countries did, and I was actually quite critical about this, but thankfully I was away and my hands are washed of these things. Mm. These guys thought that, well, we create a presidential political system, and then we also have a parliament. That it means, therefore, that the president, in this case, or the leader of the party, Comrade Chagulanyi, does not necessarily need to be a member of parliament. Then who leads the opposition in parliament? You alluded to the question in Britain. In Britain, most leaders of political parties and opposition parties will be members of parliament. Mm. So it makes it actually easy, like Angus Emery, may his soul rest.
Yes,
in
how he used to be the leader.
He
of opposition.
He was the leader of the opposition, but also a member of parliament.
Absolutely.
So in that case, he was leading the parliamentary processes on behalf of the mainstream opposition.
So it would have been different if Chagulanyi was in, for example.
It would have been different for that. But maybe also that fudges the complication. So maybe this serves them right. So we want to make sure that we see. Yes. A leader of opposition outside parliament, but who's absolutely in charge of the political party, leading legislators in the National Assembly, leading his party cabinet, wherever they are, and leading the views and aspirations of the members of the party across the country. That, by and large, should be the democratic thing. My problem is, though, is that how do national executive of these political parties meet and say, these are our legislative programs, these are our agenda. You know, when UPC taunted the NRAs and DPs about manifestos, people thought we were making political points. No, what is required of a sensible political party at the level of a democratic alternative government is to say that this is what we represent and this is how we go. This is how we shall present ourselves in the National Assembly, run on issues. So it makes it easier for the leader of opposition that when we go to conduct ourselves in the National Assembly, we are pushing issues that is consistent with the values of our political organization, values some other conversation, or this is basically the position of our members based on the delegates conference, or by and large, this is the views
One would argue actually that Chagulanyi might be the problem, but actually the previous leaders of opposition who have not been in parliament, for example, Honorable Genga Latigo, the Honorable Wafula Ogutu, Nandala Mafabi, Honorable Winnie Kiza, Honorable Beta Wall, most of them have actually had these issues before during their tenure of service. Why is it so hard for leaders of opposition in parliament to balance, to maintain and uphold the rules in the house, but at the same time serve their master, who is actually the leader of the political party which they subscribe to?
They should not be serving the interest of the their master, and if there is a political...
But it's the one appointing them, is the appointing authority in the first place.
You're appointed to serve, and that's part of the problem. That's a patronage system that NRA has created in this country. When you're elected to whatever position, you appoint a particular position, you serve the interest, by and large, the leader of the position in Parliament. In fact, should not only be serving the interests of all the members of the mainstream political opposition, but should be cognizant of the views of all the other opposition political parties. Because basically, he or she is the lead person on behalf of everybody else. But most importantly, the leader of opposition in Parliament, just like actually the Speaker of Parliament, just like the Prime Minister, leader of government business in Parliament, in a normal UPC administration system, just like the President, should be serving the interests of the country. So the leader of the opposition, when facing whatever it is on the square, should be saying, what is right? What is right for this country? Most importantly, how does it reconcile with the interests of my party? You know, and in serving this National Assembly, a hugely privileged job, a leader of opposition.
Actually, you know, majority of, for example, supporters of National Unity Platform and the Forum for Democratic Change, majority of them, I would say they are radicals. They want to have this extreme politics. They want to show that actually, you know, activism, populist politics on the floor of Parliament. You saw what Honorable Zake did. How should a leader of opposition, for example, handle such a situation?
I'm not sure.
Because you're breaking the rules of the House, that's one, and your member is referred to the committee, and then the next day, you hear that you want to be reshuffled because you seem to look like you are soft for the ruling government.
Radicalism in political terms is nothing bad. You know, if you're a radical political party, just show us your manifesto and your programs and show us that radically, in the event that we're in government, this is how we shall change, cause change in this country. Radicalism does not necessarily mean that you
intolerant.
You breach the rules of procedure, for example.
That's the interpretation that actually many of the supporters have.
Yeah, and that's unfortunate. But also on the other hand, I might actually protect these guys by saying that, well, when you find a National Assembly in which security services come and break and systems and jump on legislators and break them, you know, it causes a reaction. So from that point of view, maybe these opposition leaders go down there to try and prove that, well, they are as tough as the governing alternative that they're trying to oppose or perhaps to unseat. And from my point of view, I think the right thing would be that a leader of opposition presents the holistic alternative way of doing things. This country is extremely unfortunate, very unlucky, that since 1985 it has not seen what a UPC government would do or a mainstream alternative UPC opposition would do. And by and large, I think our early guys like the Cecilias, even in that restricted assembly, most of the UPC leaders in the assembly did a sterling exemplary performance, although it was under an NRA monolithic system. So where we are at the moment, I think, I would urge that my brother Chagulanyi recognizes what his primary job is to provide the leadership, you know, doesn't represent my views, but the leadership by virtue of what the country did by giving him the highest number of legislators and therefore by definition necessarily the largest alternative government one. And that too, because he's the leader to be able to ensure that whoever he is supervising, whether in the National Assembly, in the streets in Kampala, or anywhere else, portray and represent that which is an alternative, sensible thing, not to outsmart the NRA in their package. Because if we want to outsmart the NRA guys, we might have to look for bushes in Mabira. And that's not what I'm advising today, because I'm simply saying that, well, politics must be about a competition of ideas and offering the citizens of this country an alternative set of values. I would like to see a situation in which the mainstream opposition in this country taunt NRA on corruption, taunt NRA on a case like I've just heard this morning, where a young Ugandan girl is suffering from hernia in Saudi Arabia, and she's begging through social media to be required to return. Where is her local member of parliament? Where's the responsible minister? Where are the NRA guys as ministers? What is the Minister for Workforce, Foreign Affairs? So the more we actually mainstream, if you don't mind, the more we mainstream issues in the National Assembly, you know, in terms of those things that matter to our citizens, the easier the jobs will be for the Mpugas. And I've actually argued several times, quite critical about the opposition. About 10 or so years ago, I had a conversation with some opposition leaders that part of the problem is that we wake up in the morning and deal with the child in Saudi Arabia that I'm trying to talk about, and then we score points. And by evenings, we go to the headlines, we're very happy. My name is appearing on all the key media networks and newspapers. And the following day is business as usual, things are quiet. And in another 5 days' time, we've picked another opportunistic thing about the Pakwach Rail Bridge, which is broken up the other day, and Ucheno on his way to Nebi, things like that. It should not really be like that. We should pick on issues, run with it, and actually put this government on the defense.
Given the situation, yes, yes. Would you advise Mpuga to resign?
I don't want
in a normal political setting.
actually, they're asking President Cyril Ramaphosa to resign.
To resign, yes.
Neither here nor there. No, I do not know the details, but I must say that Mpuga possibly has not made it easy for himself. He's fairly a solid, rounded guy. I had quite a lot of respect for him. I still do. When people begin to suggest nuances about your alliances with the other side and their question marks, and this country is a country that is full of mafia, it's your job at a leadership level to make it impossible to be suspected. Obote says that that which concerns all must be discussed by all. You should not make it easy for anybody to suspect you. If Mpuga was playing right by the game and saying, folks, this is the situation, this is how we're going to do it, this explain yourself about it. If there are some guys in Noop who are looking rather streetwise as far as policy implementation are concerned, those things will come out thanks to guys like yourselves in the media that look, no, Mpuga is the sensible one here. If it is the case that it's Robert who's dithering, you know, the country will expose him as Mr. Dithera, who has no clue what's happening in the National Assembly.
Absolutely.
So, I'm afraid that's what leadership. Leadership is a tough game. You'll not be able to please everybody.
Yes.
I had to learn it the hard way. And as far as I'm concerned, no, you do the right thing, but you also clearly articulate and communicate for yourself. Repeat, leader of the opposition's job is not to do the allowances. Leader of the opposition's job is to provide the country with an alternative set of values. And under our circumstances at the moment...
How effective is that? Because certainly many of the supporters of, for example, National Unity Platform and the FDC, when it was still in parliament, rather, as the main leading opposition, this kind of approach that certainly, you know, that is looked at as if it's a soft approach. You don't spit venom, you just keep quiet.
Nothing
and
softly doing that, in a good way.
Yes, certainly. But is this how effective is that approach? And under the circumstances, many of the people would say, but this NRM government hears protests, guns, and all of that. In such circumstances, as a leader of opposition, what would you be doing?
I'm not sure if they get it right. I don't know what else they should do except to do the right things in parliament. One other thing that I've been challenging this NRA regime about also is that, and this is very urgent, we should have possibilities where Makerere University students, dissatisfied about certain tendencies, are allowed to picket in front of the Senate building. We should have a situation in which instead of these funny sirens pushing some of these dubious guys whom I don't understand, there are too many in this country,
yes.
You know, those sirens should close off one day, get road for a few minutes and allow a few hundred students to come and vent off in front of Bank of Uganda. Mm. You don't agree with your policy arrangements. And once in a while to come to the National Assembly. So the legislators say, oh, the citizens are angry down the street and line them and take part. That is democracy. In as long as in this country, every protest, every demonstration is presented as extreme opposition and security nonsense, I reject that and we shall have some of this position. Now, the problem is, on a serious note, the more that happens, the more we shall have the difficulties of the Mpugas and then the Jagulanis and perhaps some what you call the radicals else in there. Mm. And people begin to think and seek alternative ways of managing or seeking change. And when such things actually do happen, there are people in this regime who think it's actually good because for them, you know, they continue to enjoy 40 years in here. You know, no, we are serving the interests of the devil. We are not preparing for a possibility where our children are able to go through a democratic environment in which we nurture leaders who are responsible, who learn to be good leaders in opposition and good leaders in government. And I must say, my little experience, as you said, I think as you hinted, in the British Labour Party and Britain, it's an amazing, exciting experience when you see a parliamentary process in which the leader of the opposition, in this case perhaps, who was also a member of the National Assembly and in government, and these guys will do their squaring on Wednesday, and after that they go ahead and shake hands and walk together. Mm. You know, there'll be a move to, you know, perhaps state opening of parliament and define the
and I thought this is what Mpuga is trying to do.
The Prime Minister
is trying to emulate.
No, you know, sometimes putting on a border shirt and hand. No, that's fine if he's doing it, but I'm saying, you know, is he trying to emulate? Or I know you're a journalist. He's trying to emulate. No, point is, if he's doing that genuinely, that is fine. There have been allegations and claims of maybe some elements of crossing the floor, which are neither here nor there. I take a very exceptional, rare opportunity to use my own UPC, where until today I get really very frustrated. You know, people say is a Kenna UPC is Museveni.
Yes.
You know, kind of stuff. You know, first of all, Akena is not president of UPC. I'm sorry to just bring this to just give an example. Akena is not president. No, he's not president of the party because he's not because the Court of Appeal ruled against him. Number one. But then number two, you are dancing with Museveni, but you're not going to tell your members what exactly is happening. Mm. That makes life rather difficult. Simply say, we're enjoying night dancing with these guys, we're going for an afternoon thing with this, or this is the deal like Norbert Mao did. Mm. I brought it very deliberately because these are national conversations that must be had. But also on the other hand, if in this case Mpuga is trying to play the decent guy, it is... he should just continue playing the decent guy and let Mr. Chairman.
But he's a decent guy.
No, that's what
certainly.
I'm trying to say that.
He's not just playing the decent guy. He's a decent
meaning,
guy.
Meaning, but play in the sense that let him continue his role as the decent guy. Be very clear what he's pushing. Have a very open conversation with his leader and have a very decent conversation with his party and have a very decent conversation with the country. You know, that is what needs to be done. And I don't see... You know, I don't see these guys doing enough of that. They actually forget that their responsibility is to the country first. Mm. The other thing, though, which is also a very quick one, is in the manner in which some of these party organizations are at the moment, is that Mpuga is the leader of opposition, Chagulani is there.
And the leader of the party. Yeah, is the de facto Ayatollah.
Necessarily, the leader of the party. And then there is a secretary general of the party. Mm. So power play begins to roll around.
Yes.
In a mainstream organized political party, and these guys are quite free.
And certainly the president of the party, the secretary general of the party, are not in parliament. And that can as well create a crisis. How should a good leader of opposition be selected or elected? Because we had scenarios where Ogengala Tigo, for example, was elected by their National Executive Committee. Now, all the subsequent leaders of oppositions were just selected by the leaders of those main opposition parties. Is there something that we need to change in this country so that we have these leaders of opposition elected from their party organizations and structures?
Not necessarily.
Will it cure, actually? Will it provide very good
remedies? But I don't think, that's why I told you about the contradiction of the political process. For me, and the NRO guys would be laughing on this, the desired political system on this continent, because of this big man, mainly men syndrome, is I would go for a complete parliamentary system, long term. But not under an NRA, they should, because it should be not be them to be able to do that, because they'll do it to fit their interests. But long term, we should go for a complete parliamentary system in which we actually don't have a direct elected
elections
party.
For,
you know,
adult suffrage.
The largest political, the way it was happening before independence, you know, that would solve some, in my opinion, solve some of this.
Proportional representation?
No. Basically, just mainstream parliamentary system. Proportional representation may be included in that. Proportional representation can also be very tasty, very in this way. But generally, that's the thing. But of course, you know, these guys brought the presidential system. They thought they were blocking voting Lusaka, which was basically unfortunate. And then they created another new monster, in terms of different kind of power bases. That means, therefore, that you're a leader of a party, you run together, you mobilize, then you seek to maximize the number of parliamentary seats, and the largest political party forms the government. In this case, actually, they could even decide that the leader of the party, who is not in parliament, whoever, decides, they actually vote for the president again, in theory.
Yes.
Although, you know, so they do that. I think then when it comes to the localized way of representation, that was your question, I think whether these guys are directly elected by a delegates conference, for instance, or perhaps by the party or party cabinet, is neither here nor there. My preferred choice, way of doing it, would be like almost the election of Speaker. And that is, if Uganda People's Congress, and God willing, we get our houses in order and sorted fairly soon, that we get 170 parliamentary seats at the next election. And possibly Ocheno, the president, is possibly not necessarily in there
in
for whatever reason.
Fun, yes,
you know, I would rather the ideal, the 170 members of the of the party, you know,
elect
their chairperson, their spokesperson, you know, in the National Assembly. For me, by the way, in the future UPC,
who would serve like the leader of opposition?
By the time somebody becomes a legislator, a candidate for parliament, there should be sensible men and women.
And they should be actually qualified
to be
president.
I'm very excited because I've got an emerging young group of young guys coming, and I hope that by the time they become equivalent councillors and members of parliament, there'll be decent men and women ready and responsible to lead this country at particular levels. So these guys in their late 20s, early 30s, whatever, they should be able to organize and mobilize themselves, and then the pick first among us equals as the leader of the opposition political party in parliament. I think that debars these things. The president, the leader of the party, will have his or her nuances, you know, they might influence. That happens, you know, for different reasons. Maybe is it so and so. But I think the way I would like to see it, I would rather the leaders allow
the members themselves,
to do that. And that's why I was very particular that the Speaker of Parliament, and I hope Mr. Museveni, in a future situation arises, that particularly if you have the largest political party, you know the largest political party represented in Parliament, and you really...
The NRM actually has been doing this.
No, of course.
They have.
No.
They have actually going to, you know, the caucus has always been going to...
Caucus been instructed again, as you said.
No,
not
Joseph,
going,
Joseph,
instructed.
Reality is the caucus has been going, and they are electing their own party caucus chairperson, but also the speaker. They have been actually going and convening.
Okay, so let's do it.
And they select the names.
Okay, let's do the NRA way, the NRA democracy.
You know, the NRM democracy.
The NRA democracy. Yes. That you have 300 legislators, you give these men and women opportunity to elect one of theirs as first amongst equals. This is going to be our supervisor in the National Assembly. That, in my opinion,
will
is
it cure the problems that actually, for example, Mpuga and his predecessors actually faced?
In many ways, yes. But also on the other
because hand, it didn't sort out the problem, for example, with Latigo. Yes, Latigo, when he was still serving
as... What was Latigo's problem? Latigo's problem was not an issue with some of his colleagues later. Again, Latigo's a fantastic friend of mine. So I don't know to go now. So really, no, these things, those are not the issues. And I can also tell you something else. And that in the event that such a thing does happen, part of the problem this country is facing is the level of attrition of legislators. Now, I think I think my good friend Chikatesh the other day talked about nearly 80% attrition. So it means that we really don't have many experienced, and this is good guys, many experienced guys who are solid. By the time you're qualified to be a Speaker of the National Assembly, you should show that you're somebody who's reasonably moderate, collegiate, responsible.
Jacob was, gotten to...
Yeah, something along those lines, actually fairly solid, rather independent. Mm-hmm. But no, you have this country, you have the political organization you represent, because some of them are not political parties, you know, in interest, you know, and so you're able to try and push and people come ahead and forward. And in as long as it's that, you realize that by the time names begin to appear, who?
Exactly.
There's a port of five, six, seven guys. But also what it does in democracy, and that's why good manners in schools also happen. Mm. People know that when I go to join the National Assembly, I need to behave well. I don't need to break people's legs before I reach political, because time may come when I might require the votes of my colleagues. Mm. That's why politics of impunity, when you see national politics, Museveni doesn't really care. He can even tell you that I'm the one who broke the coffee deal. Go do whatever, because he knows you're not going to have a capacity to be able to do anything. But if he knew public opinion matters, if he knew the mandate of the people matter, oh no, he would be play humility. You see how old Milton used to do? Play humility, because one, you know the responsibility of the job, but also you know that these are your power bases. The more we're able to do that, the better. So, you know, attrition in terms of members for this. So really, therefore, perhaps a first-timer legislator should not qualify, because they would say that, well, maybe they lack the experience. And parliamentarians, because you ask my opinion, and as I said, I've engaged with a number of parliaments around the world. You know,
now, in scenarios, scenarios where actually the said leader of opposition, for example, Mpuga, because these are talks within the corridors of parliament, where Mpuga is looked at if he's quite more experienced politically than the leader of the party that he's representing.
And to be fair, they came as a wave anyway one time.
Absolutely. Yeah. And how would you really be effective serving a person that everybody's clearly know that is you more smarter than him and you are more effective politically than him?
Yeah, you guys, this is...
That's quite a dilemma.
No.
Is Mpuga actually the dilemma?
No, that's a very unfair question. As I said again, Mpuga in the National Assembly should show leadership as a leader of the opposition in Parliament, serving the interests of all. It's not a competition, it's not a beauty pageant.
These allegations are put in place by the NRM guys. They are saying Mpuga is in a dilemma because he has to do the right thing, but at the same time has to serve his incompetent or inexperienced leader. The
NRM guys will do that, and it's rather cheeky of them, isn't it? Because what experience did Museveni have in 1980 in terms of parliamentary process? In fact, he doesn't have any parliamentary process. Come to think, well, this is shocking. It's a crisis. We've been ruled and led for 40 years by someone who has gotten no parliamentary experience, Mr. Museveni.
And he was the Speaker of Parliament for some time.
Which parliament? Mm.
It was effective, the NRC.
Okay. No. So I don't think that is the issue. The NRA guys are enjoying this, and I think the sooner, therefore, sorts itself out, the better for the opposition, the better for this country. And the better for us so that we're able to mobilize and push on the real issues. No, I do not think it's...
Under the circumstances. How do you go about that?
No, because I'm still telling you. You know, Mr. Museveni talks economics, but he leads professors of economics, you know. You know, Museveni and Mutebile, my good brother, late, he's so resident. Who's the sharper guy? Of course, Museveni. Mutebile. No, but he is, quote, the president. Mpuga's job, Mpuga should not get carried away. And I know sometimes some of these things the devil can play. you're serving that guy who's less.
Who is in, yes,
so
absolutely.
how do you judge, you know, intelligence? How do you judge sharpness? Is it through academic
qualifications?
Is it through experience in terms of jobs? And, people have argued, and some elder FDC person who's former NRA radical, actually, you know, once said in a very kind way to Chagulanyi, that Chagulanyi should be seen in this context, that he grew up in from Kamocha. I lived in that slum, by the way, went through the slum, went to music, became very successful, made a huge amount of money, managed to convince certain people that he could actually move, push the people power thing, push that, test the National Assembly, went in as an independent legislator, succeeded, whatever all the dynamics, and is now leading this political organization. Mm. So credit to the young man that you don't do it very easy.
That's true.
That saying, my issue is with this country. I think people are basically just looking that after 40 years of Mr. Museveni, after 40 years of failed NRA, after 40 years of the big challenges we have in terms of the division, and the NRA guys don't say that they brought national unity. No, there's no. This country is much more disintegrated. Than it was 40 years ago.
But rather more and peaceful than it was.
I don't know what you call peace. If peace is the disappearance of people, if peace is the young girl, we are begging for the, whoever is responsible to be able to deal with.
But these cases happen everywhere, Joseph. It's not only in Uganda. They happen even in the democracies that actually you admire more. Fantastic. They do happen.
In which case, then it's not more peaceful than it was in 1980s, in the 80s.
Certainly we also had very few people. The population was not
that
as
is
big as this.
I don't know what.
No, it's not simplistic. Just some of these cases, for example,
peace is harder in a population of 45 than
by the way, yes. By the way, because like for example, if you're talking about peace, what would be your measurement? If you're saying disappearances, you're saying abductions that actually National Unity Platform people are talking about, these things happen in other countries.
It's not National Unity people.
So these are criminal, incidents and isolated in that nature. This is one of the most peaceful countries, by the way, Joseph.
Can I give you an answer?
Mm-hmm.
You know, peace is not only absence of war. Peace is a situation in which there is justice, there's equity. In a situation in which a citizen of this country disappears and nobody in the security agency is able to say yes. A situation in which somebody is arrested on so-called drone, because I don't even like using those words, you know, because they taunt me, that I live in Uganda, a country run by NRA, NRA that went to the bush and taunted our people and used to throw bombs and grenades in the streets of Kampala, by the way, seeking government. And 40 years later, they've got to go through this process. That's not peace. And if you talk about Ugandan peace, you know, I have traveled around this country until recently. Up to last week, I was in West Nile. The other week, I was in Eastern Uganda. On Independence Day, I passed via Mukura. Nowhere, torture and this. So what peace? Neither here nor there. But do you know one thing? I am saying, genuinely, this country can be peaceful. The country can also be one in which there is absolute rule of law. And this country can also be in a situation in which where legislators go to the National Assembly, and that's why I'm happy and I'm regretful you invited me on this program, that whoever legislates does not legislate to score political points, but they legislate for our citizens and countries. And the situation in which no member of parliament slapped, because it never happened in previous governments, you know, certainly not in the previous two governments, MPs are slapped, MPs are banned from band organs, talk about peace. Those are the comparisons. But I'm also bringing that deliberately so that young citizens of this country know alternatives of the past, but possibilities of the future. My entirety of thought is always that whatever happened in Uganda before and today should be about giving peace and possibility for the youth of this country, so that we're able to live in Uganda, which has got more population like you desire, but one which is peaceful, prosperous for all. So, what are we saying? The leader of opposition should know that the burden of responsibility lies with them to put on notice and challenge the government programs. The leader of opposition should find ways by which they work with their leaders, political leaders. But maybe this is telling us that what is more urgent now is that while Mpuga and Chagulanyi battle this, that we ask, where is FDC? We ask, where is ANT? And that's why I can't wait for a time when we're able to resolve the leadership of Uganda People's Congress so that UPC can come on the table and begin to provide the genuine leadership that is opposition.
But these are not matters that concern them. For example, the leader of opposition is not appointed.
No. Why I'm saying this, very importantly, is because the leader of opposition's job is to
also coordinate other opposition parties in parliament.
Indeed, and to critique and offer alternatives.
Yes,
I'm continuously talking about the alternative, because by and large, that's what it should be. And that's why it's extremely critical that NRA guys sometimes laugh that they're not challenged enough. And that's maybe one of the reasons why some good friends of ours, Noob, think that my good friend Matthias Mpuga
is not doing his job right.
No, I think Mr. Mpuga needs to find a balance somewhere in between. If in Chagulanyi's case, I think I would sympathize with him. If it is the case that, as alleged, that Mr. Mpuga is too comfortable, you know, then that is very difficult for Mr. Chagulanyi, and I think it would be very unfair to expect some miracles to come out of him. But one thing I want to clear again is that for us, and to allow NRA to push the narrative about the qualification of Chagulanyi.
The NRM, not the NRM.
They shouldn't, because that's not their job. Their job is to push their program. Let the guys in NUP determine who their leader is. Let the guys let the guys in DP do whatever it is now that my good friend and is there in the constitution. and let the guys in ANT do whatever it is. For us in UPC, we're very clear. As I said, we're going to resolve our position, take our position, and definitely we're not in any deal with NRA. And there will be
that's a different yes. that's a different discussion.
Yeah, yeah.
But Joseph, as we are winding up this whole conversation, under the circumstances, under the system that we are having, can we really have an effective leader of opposition under the circumstances?
Yes.
Or it is something that is beyond, for example, Mathias Mpuuga or the National Unity Platform, and it has to be sorted out from the source?
No. You deal with what you've got at the moment. I don't know when the constitution is going to be changed so that that position is erased.
Mm.
It's not going to happen soon. Right now, NUP are the leaders of opposition until the next election.
Yes.
And unless the citizens of this country become awake and realize that NRS had a little bit of his time and they give us a new government, which I hope happens, you know, the youth of this country should gain courage and do that at the ballot box, you know, and then we find NRA as the third party so that we have a new leader of opposition, the situation will remain the same. So where we are at the moment, it is basically up to NUP to provide the leadership. And this, I think then there's more incumbent upon, on a serious note now, on Mr. Chagulanyi to Mr. Chagulanyi, his Secretary General, and Mr. Mpuuga to sit together and try and cleanse this so that this topic we've had is that we spend 30 minutes in the morning challenging NRA on key issues of health, key issues of education, key issues of infrastructure, key issues of the environment, key issues of agriculture, key issues of jobs, and above all, key issues of this thing, cancer called corruption.
Should he seek assistance from his predecessors and how they managed, for example, the Professor Latigos of this world?
That's interesting. I hope.
Maybe he's not also that experienced in handling leaders of opposition.
No, my telephone, my line is free. My line is open. I've not been leader of opposition in Uganda, but I'll give them thorough advice. And I've been telling them, and absolutely free. That would be. But I don't think it's that. Some of these things in the borrowed chats are neither here nor there. No, it is less about Mpuuga, the person, but more about what is the underlying. If Mpuuga is just trying to do his best and is not anything else that you know people read about, then the best we can do is to find urgent way to this time. Maybe he can possibly lead to call his leader and say that, look, you know, let's take all these things from the headlines and concentrate on the business this country gave us as a privilege to be the second largest political organization in this country at this material time, and that's putting these guys to task and presenting an alternative set of agenda for this country.
Is it time actually to have, let's say, leaders of those political parties, opposition parties, appear in parliament, and would such an amendment actually provide
actually,
a better alternative?
You know, I was thinking about that, it's very interesting, that I think possibly leaders of opposition political parties who are not legislators should actually have the privilege. And when you talk about a constitutional amendment, is that either where you're looking at the proportional representation, but also it may also be the case that maybe leaders of the main opposition parties could become nominated members of parliament. And after all, we have 10 members of the NRA who are in the assembly. I don't know what the job is when you have ministers.
No, they are not NRA. They are UPDF.
NRA.
They are UPDF members of parliament. They represent our army.
Museveni tells that his boys and a few girls from the bush. You know, whatever. So, but no, they're serving in our national. I mean, they're fantastic.
But actually, that amendment will also make the president come to parliament, certainly.
But, by the way, my view is that actually it should, that all leaders, in which case that perhaps leaders with a certain threshold should become automatically nominated
members of parliament.
And by that, it would be very, very good, meaning that it would perhaps deal with some of the same. But it's actually much more democratic. People don't see this. So, meaning putting these guys on the hoop. So, maybe it would actually resolve
some of these contradictions.
This lacuna, yes.
And tendencies within the parties. Thank you so much, Joseph, for actually sparing time to speak to me. This morning, we've been discussing the bickering within the main opposition political party, that is the National Unity Platform. With me has been Joseph Ocheno. Now we want to continue this whole conversation with the former member of parliament of Chadondo East, and that's Honorable Apollo Kantinti, who will be joining Miles Ramiti in Rush Talk and on Gawe.
Big size, man, cool. Now, that you say chameleon.